Hi everyone, my name is Ashraf Elazouni. I'm an interventional cardiologist working in Toronto, Canada. I work in Scarborough Health Network and Lake Ridge Health. I was invited to talk about chest pain. So I'll talk in general about an approach to chest pain, but I'll focus on the cardiac causes of it. So here is the outline of the talk. We'll talk about a case and then the differential diagnosis for chest pain. Then we'll talk more specifically about coronary artery disease and how you can assess the probability of it being the cause of chest pain. We'll talk about the ways to stress the heart and the ways to assess for ischemia so that you know how to choose the appropriate stress test for that patient when you suspect coronary artery disease, and then we'll get back to the case at the end. So here is the case. This is actually a case that I treated about 2 to 3 weeks ago. It's a fresh one. Essentially, this is a 62-year-old male patient. He's a smoker with a past medical history of diabetes mellitus type 2. He started having chest pain while driving his truck in New York State. He was about an hour or so from the border. And unfortunately, he decided to just keep driving until he's on the Canadian side. The pain was described as retrosternal, radiating to the left arm. He did cross the border and then presented to our urgent care, but it was about 8 to 9 hours following the onset of chest pain. So the question to you is, what would you do to this patient if you see him in the clinic? Like, would you assume it is an acidity and give him an acidity medication? Would you just send him to see a cardiologist as an outpatient in a couple of weeks? Or will you immediately assess him and do an ECG and, if abnormal, treat it accordingly? I'll get back to the case at the end to show you how did it turn out. But to talk about chest pain, as you all know, chest pain remains among the top reasons patients present to emergency departments and primary care. When you look at all the causes of death, cardiovascular causes remain the top number one cause of death in the world in general, as per the WHO recent data. There are other causes, and COVID is changing the distribution, but still cardiovascular cause is the main cause. When you see any patient with chest pain, I think it is very important to remember the differential diagnosis for the possible causes of chest pain. That will help you decide what to do next for that patient and how to make the diagnosis and how to make the treatment. I think the main thing on the differential diagnosis to keep in mind is coronary artery disease. And it comes in different forms. On one end of the spectrum, there is the stable coronary artery disease, where patients have stable angina that limits them when they do exercise and so on. While on the other end of the spectrum, there are the acute coronary syndrome causes, whether it is unstable angina, non-ST elevation myocardial infarction, or ST elevation myocardial infarction. To me, I think coronary artery disease is one of the main causes of chest pain that you should keep in mind, because it is a life-threatening one that you need to diagnose appropriately and start the treatment in a timely fashion. But beside coronary artery disease, there are many other causes of chest pain. As you can see in this table, there are other cardiovascular causes of chest pain. There are ones related to aortic aneurysms and dissection. There are ones related to myopericarditis, and there is stress-induced cardiomyopathy. But remember, usually stress-induced cardiomyopathy present as non-STEMI or STEMI, and then we make the diagnosis when we do the cath. So it is a diagnosis of exclusion. There are other causes of chest pain related to the chest wall, mainly musculoskeletal causes like costochondritis, like rib fracture, like herpes zoster, and so on. There are pulmonary causes of chest pain, like pleuritis, pneumonia, but more importantly, a pulmonary embolism and tension pneumothorax can cause chest pain, things to keep in mind because they can be life-threatening. Then there are the psychiatric causes of chest pain, mainly related to anxiety and stress. And finally, there are the gastrointestinal causes of chest pain. It could be something related to the esophagus, like acidity causing pain or even esophageal spasm. And rarely, an ulcer and rupture can cause pain in the epigastric area. There are the biliary causes of pain, but mainly they affect the right upper quadrant. Sometimes they radiate to the shoulder. And there are the pancreatitis causes of chest pain. I think something to keep in mind is, as I mentioned, we really need to keep the four main ones that are life-threatening in the back of our minds whenever we see someone with chest pain. As I mentioned, number one, coronary artery disease-related causes. Number two, aortic dissection. Number three, pulmonary embolus. And number four, tension pneumothorax. I thought to talk about each one of them briefly, and then we'll talk about the coronary artery disease causes in more depth. So aortic dissection, as you all know, is a very important cause of chest pain to be diagnosed properly. Usually patients are sicker, and usually they tend to present to emergency rooms with severe pain. The pain starts as an abrupt pain. It sometimes feels like tearing pain that goes through the chest all the way to the back, to the mid-scapular area. Such patients usually has a history of hypertension, and usually initially when they present with aortic dissection, the blood pressure is very high, and then as the dissection propagates, they might tend to lose their pressure and then pulse, and they go into shock afterward. Something we notice on physical examination when we see such patients is the difference in blood pressure between both arms, and sometimes we see pulse deficit. If the dissection involves the origin of the circulation to the brain, then neurological deficits can start there. If you do see such a patient with chest pain and you suspect aortic dissection, if it is still like a borderline suspicion, you can start with a chest X-ray. And the main thing we look for is the widening of the mediastinum. So if you take a look at this X-ray here, so we look at both sides of the trachea from here to the edge of the mediastinum and compare it with the other side. So obviously here there is widening of the mediastinum that is very concerning for aortic aneurysm with dissection. But the diagnosis is usually made on a CT angiogram where we can see the dissection flap and we see the true lumen and false lumen. And essentially, if the dissection involves the ascending aorta, then it is a type A dissection and they need an emergent surgery. The second cause of chest pain I want to talk about today, which is a very important one to diagnose, is pulmonary embolism. It also starts with sudden onset chest pain. Usually they describe it as a pleuritic pain, where if the patient takes a deep breath in, they feel the pain getting worse with taking the deep breath in. Usually patients are tachycardic when the pain is related to pulmonary embolism because of the hemodynamical effects of the pulmonary embolism and the strain it causes on the heart. Something to think about when you see a patient with chest pain, if you are suspecting pulmonary embolism, is to look at their risk factors for developing a thrombus. The main ones to think about are if the patient is known to have any inherited thrombophilia, but then you also should look at if the patient is known to have any malignancy, if the patient is bedridden, if the patient is on oral contraceptives, hormonal replacement therapy, and so on. So the more risk factors the patient has, the higher the chance that this patient pain is related to pulmonary embolism, and the more is the need to work up the patient for pulmonary embolism in this situation. ECG is a very important test to do if you suspect pulmonary embolism. The main thing you would normally see on an ECG in a patient with pulmonary embolism is actually sinus tachycardia, especially if there is strain on the heart from the pulmonary embolism itself. There are other clues that sometimes we see on the ECG, like the sign we call S1, Q3, T3 sign, essentially a deep S wave in lead 1, a deep Q wave in lead 3, and inverted T wave in lead T3. If you see it in someone with chest pain, especially with sinus tachycardia, this is really, really suspicious for pulmonary embolism. So then what tests you can do? If the suspicion is low to intermediate, a D-dimer is a very helpful test then, because it can help you rule out pulmonary embolism. Because if it come back negative, then this is a very helpful test to rule out pulmonary embolism. But to rule in and make a diagnosis of pulmonary embolism, usually you need a CT pulmonary angiogram that can show you the actual thrombus in the pulmonary artery, and then the treatment is with anticoagulation. And really, if the patient is very sick from the pulmonary embolism with almost hemodynamical collapse, then we talk about either using thrombolytics or an invasive way to retrieve the thrombus. But that's in the very rare subset of patients there. The third cause of chest pain that I want to talk about, which is a life-threatening one, is tension pneumothorax. Like similar to the other chest pain causes that I just talked about, it causes sudden onset chest pain. Usually it is sharp, pleuritic pain. There is hyper-resonance when you listen to the patient chest in this situation, and decreased breath sounds. And the way to diagnose tension pneumothorax is by doing a chest X-ray. And what you will see, if that's the case, is hyperlucency on one side of the chest. And if there is tension, you will see that the pneumothorax is actually creating pressure on that side of the chest, pushing the whole mediastinum and the heart to the other side, and that by itself can trigger hemodynamical collapse if left untreated. So it is very important to treat it, so to diagnose it quickly and treat it accordingly, essentially by relieving the pressure initially by a needle or a small catheter, and then usually thoracic surgeons need to be involved to take a look at why did the patient develop pneumothorax to start with and how to prevent it from happening again. So going back to the differential diagnosis, as I mentioned, these are the four, these are the ones that I talked about, the three plus the coronary artery disease causes of chest pain that are life-threatening. But there are other ones to keep in mind once you rule out the major life-threatening ones. There are ones related to chest wall, like costochondritis, but usually it is located at that junction between the cartilage and the sternum, and it is tender to the touch and painful. There is herpes zoster as a possible cause of chest pain, but usually patients have such a history from before, or a few days later they end up developing the rash. There are the rib fracture causes of chest pain, but usually they are preceded by some sort of a trauma and so on. From the pulmonary point of view, there are the pneumonia causes of chest pain, but usually they have other symptoms like fever, cough, and so on. The psychiatric ones, as I mentioned, are related to anxiety and stress, and then there are the gastrointestinal causes of chest pain. I want to add to this slide the following. COVID-19 is actually one of the newer entities that cause chest pain that we have been dealing with recently. But from what I have noticed from the many patients that had COVID pneumonia that I had treated, the chest pain is generally caused by COVID-19 causing another issue like myocarditis in the heart, or causing actually a clot in the coronary arteries, causing a heart attack, or sometimes causing a pulmonary embolus, causing the chest pain. So essentially the COVID-19 end up as part of causing a complication, causing something like the ones I just mentioned, and then cause chest pain that way. Something to keep in mind in someone who's presenting to you with shortness of breath and fever, as well as chest pain. So I want to shift gears now and talk more about coronary artery disease and how you assess such patients. I want to mention, first of all, that when you see a patient of chest pain, there are two kinds of situations you will encounter such patients, especially when it is related to the heart. So there is the patient that will come to you with chest pain that has been happening on and off, and now they are asking you about it, and they want your input about how to address it and so on. And there are the patients who will come to you to the clinic looking unwell, having chest pain, having nausea, having vomiting, which is a different subset and should be dealt with on urgent emergent base, rather than like the one who's having chest pain on recurrent basis along the way. So when you see someone who has been having chest pain like regularly over a span of few weeks and so on before coming to see you in the clinic, something to ask you to ask yourself about is how typical is that chest pain to be called angina or related to coronary artery? So it has to have three characteristics so that we call it typical angina. Number one, it has to be a retrosternal chest pain. Number two, provoked by exertion or stress. Number three, relieved by rest or nitro spray use. So if the pain that the patient describes to you has the following three characteristics, then this is what we call typical angina. Very concerning. It really increases the chance of the patient pain being related to coronary artery disease. But if the pain only has two out of the three characteristics I just mentioned, then we call it atypical angina. If the pain is only retrosternal chest pain, not provoked by exertion, not provoked by rest or nitro spray, then we call it non-anginal chest pain. So by only asking the patient about the characteristics of the chest pain they have been having and classify the pain into either typical angina, atypical angina, or non-anginal chest pain, and knowing the patient sex, male or female, and knowing the patient age, you can really, in a precise way, almost predict how likely is that the patient chest pain is related to obstructive coronary artery disease causing the chest pain they have been having. In general, the older is the patient, is the higher the chance of the pain being related to coronary artery disease. If it is a typical pain, it is a higher chance that the pain is related to coronary artery disease. Males has higher chance of their pain being related to coronary artery disease compared with females. So if you just see a patient who's in his 60s with typical description of the pain, who's a male, then the likelihood that, like, that the pain is related to obstructive coronary artery disease is more than 90%. Compare that with if you see like a female in her 30s or 40s with non-anginal or atypical chest pain, then the likelihood of the pain being related to coronary artery disease is very low, less than 10%. Then there are other things to assess when you take the history and examine the patient to help you fine-tune the likelihood of the pain being related to coronary artery disease. So if the pain is in the chest or left arm, this increases the chance of the pain being related to coronary artery disease. If it radiates to left arm or both arms, this also increases the chance of it being related to coronary artery disease. If it is related to diaphoresis, also further increase the chance. There are signs that you will see on physical examination, but they are mainly in people who are having a heart attack and developing low blood pressure or signs of heart failure and so on, then that increases your level of suspicion that the pain that the patient is currently having is related to a heart attack related to coronary artery disease. There are things that if you notice on a history or physical examination, then they make the chest pain less likely to be related to coronary artery disease. If the pain is pleuritic in nature, this reduces the chance of the pain being related to coronary artery disease. It makes it more likely to be related to other things like pleuritis or PE or rarely pneumothorax. If the pain is sharp or stabbing, also makes it less likely to be related to coronary artery disease. It raises the suspicion of some other musculoskeletal causes of chest pain. If the pain is positional, also makes it less likely that the pain is related to coronary artery disease, and you think about other things like pericarditis. If you can reproduce the pain by touching the area where the pain is, then that makes the pain more likely to be related to some musculoskeletal cause, including muscle spasm and so on. Other thing to look for when you assess the patient who's coming to you with chest pain is, do they have risk factors that increases their chance of having coronary artery disease? If the patient is known to have hypertension, diabetes, especially poorly controlled diabetes or type 1 diabetes, if the patient is a smoker or obese or known to have dyslipidemia, especially if it is poorly controlled, or if the patient has family history of premature coronary artery disease, this all can help you fine-tune the likelihood of the pain being related to obstructive coronary artery disease. And what I want you to try at the end of taking the history and examining the patient is in the back of your mind to ask yourself the following question. How likely is that the patient pain that he has been having on and off for the last few weeks is being related to coronary artery disease based on what I just described to you? If you think it is low, i.e. less than 10 to 20% risk, then it is actually something that you should stop and ask yourself the question, is this non-cardiac chest pain? Should you look at the other causes of chest pain that I mentioned to you at the differential diagnosis level? Sometimes we do a coronary artery CT scan to rule out coronary artery disease in such patients, especially if they keep coming with the same pain and we cannot find another possible explanation. If you think after taking the history and examining the patient that the risk of coronary artery disease as the main cause of the patient's symptoms is high, more than 80 to 90%, then you should usually start medical therapy and plan for the patient to have a coronary artery angiogram. On the other hand, if you think that the chance of that is in the intermediate range, somewhere from 10% to 90%, then doing a stress test will help you further risk stratify and will help you further decide if the patient pain is related to coronary artery disease or something else. And here comes the point of doing stress testing. There are other indications for stress testing, but the main one I'm talking about here is using it to confirm that the patient's symptoms are related to ischemia. But there are other indications, like to assess the extent of ischemia, especially in someone that you would like to treat medically, and you just want to assess that they don't have any high-risk features indicating left main or triple vessel disease and so on as the cause of their chest pain. We use stress testing to document exercise capacity. We use it as a functional assessment tool in patients with known coronary artery disease. We use it to determine the risk and prognosis and to assess the response to treatment as well. When you think about what kind of stress test I want to order for this patient I'm seeing in front of me, especially if you don't have access to a cardiology assessment in a timely fashion, think about the stress test in this way. The stress tests, all of them are made of two components. The first component is the component by which we stress the heart. The second component is the component by which we assess if there is evidence of ischemia. You can stress the heart by either exercising the patient, putting them on a treadmill or bike, or by using pharmacological agents, mainly for patients who cannot exercise on the treadmill. Such agents are like vasodilators, like dipyridamole or adenosine, or other agents like dobutamine, which has positive chronotropic effect on the heart that increases the heart rate and pressure and mimics the effect of exercising and hence stresses the heart. The other component, as I mentioned, is to assess if there is evidence of ischemia. And we do that by three main ways that you need to choose usually between. The first one is by doing an ECG throughout the period of exercise and recovery. The second way is by doing myocardial perfusion imaging. The third way is by doing echocardiography at rest and immediately post-stress and assess if there is evidence of ischemia. I'll talk about each of these in slide details, and we'll try to explain how you can choose between the tests at the end of the talk. So as I mentioned, two components. One component is to stress the heart. The other component is to assess if there is evidence of ischemia. Stress the heart with exercise or a pharmacological agent. Assess for ischemia with either ECG, myocardial perfusion imaging, or stress echo, and you can mix and match between these modalities and essentially choose the test that works best for your patient. Remember that the degree of ischemia can be graded semi-quantitatively by each of these methods, but ischemia can be localized by the myocardial perfusion imaging or echocardiography, but not by the exercise ECG alone. So to quickly talk about the first component, which is how to stress the heart, I mentioned by exercise, either a treadmill or bicycle. There are different protocols available. The most common one we use is the Bruce protocol, which is made of several stages during which we try to push the patient until their heart rate goes up to 85% of their maximal age predicted heart rate. As I mentioned, several stages. We start at a low speed and low incline, and then we increase the speed and the incline as we go. There are different protocols like the modified Bruce protocol and so on that we use for our older patients who cannot keep up with the speed of the Bruce protocol on the treadmill. And the most common kind of test is, as I mentioned, when you combine the exercise with the ECG component, and while monitoring the patient ECG while they exercise, we look at the ST segments. There are certain patterns that will indicate for us ischemia, especially if we see downsloping ST depressions like this one or a horizontal one. If you see ST elevation, this is definitely very, very concerning for a very tight blockage that is almost going to lead to a cardiovascular event. Also upsloping ST depressions, but generally it has to be more than a downsloping or horizontal to meet the diagnostic criteria. There are high-risk features we look for when we monitor the stress test. We look at how deep the ST segment depressions are. We look at how many leads are involved. We look at if there is any ST elevation on the ECG, if there is any arrhythmia like VT, non-sustained VT, and so on, if there is a drop in blood pressure, and so on. And based on these high-risk features, we can usually report to you at the end of the test and indicate if this is a positive stress test with high-risk features or low risk features. And based on that, we decide with you about what's the next treatment option, if this will be safe for medical management alone, or you need to consider coronary angiography to rule out left main or triple vessel coronary artery disease. Remember, when you order the stress test, if the patient's baseline ECG is not normal, then you cannot just order an exercise ECG stress test, because the ECG will be not sufficient for us to monitor for ischemia. So if the patient baseline ECG has pre-excitation with delta wave, with WPW syndrome, or there is more than 1 millimeter of ST depression at rest to start with, or the patient is in digoxin with ST changes, or the patient has LVH with strain pattern, or left bundle branch block, or base rhythm, then you cannot just order exercise ECG stress test. You have to generally add another way to assess for ischemia with either myocardial perfusion imaging or stress echo to tell if there is ischemia or not in such patients. So the second way to stress the heart, I mentioned the first way is exercise. The second way is by using pharmacological agents. There are vasodilators like dipyridamole or adenosine. There are other agents like dobutamine. I'll quickly talk about each. The vasodilators, the most common one we use here in our part of town is bersentin, dipyridamole. Essentially, with coronary stenosis, differential dilatation results in differential flow and hence differential uptake of isotope. Remember, it is contraindicated in patients with severe lung disease or asthma, in patients with heart failure or severe systolic dysfunction, in patients with resting hypotension. The other way by which we can stress the heart, the other pharmacological agent is dobutamine, which is a positive inotropic and chronotropic agent. It increases the patient's heart rate and blood pressure and hence contractility and mimic the effect of exercise. We prefer it if there is a contraindication to bersentin, like if the patient is known to have severe bad asthma or critical carotid artery stenosis, especially if it is bilateral. Specific contraindications to dobutamine are the following: ventricular arrhythmias, because as I mentioned, it's a positive chronotropic agent and can increase the risk of ectopic rhythm. Aortic aneurysm or dissection is a specific contraindication, is obvious, because you don't want to increase their blood pressure when they are having a dissection or aneurysm, and that's an emergency on its own by itself. Systemic hypertension is the other specific contraindication for dobutamine, mainly if it is poorly controlled. So now to talk about myocardial perfusion imaging, which is another way by which we can assess if the patient has ischemia as part of the stress test. So there are different isotopes that are available. There are the ones that we commonly use, thallium and technetium, and then there is also PET scanning. I don't want to go into the depth here, because this is more of a subspecialized field in the cardiology field. But essentially what we do is, while we scan the patient, is we look at different sections in the heart and we look at the pictures before stress and after stress and identify if there is any defect that is there on stress that was not there on the resting images that can tell us if there is evidence of ischemia. And then based on where it is and how large it is, we can tell you if it is a significant ischemia and what artery we suspect to be the cause of the patient ischemia. Stress echocardiography is the third way by which we can assess if there is ischemia. It is based on the principle that ischemic myocardium becomes hypokinetic. A baseline echo to identify regional left ventricular function is done. Then the patient is exercised or stressed with a pharmacological agents, and then we repeat the echo immediately, and we look at each of the segments of the heart and see if there was a segment that was normal on resting images and became hypokinetic or akinetic on the post-stress images that would suggest ischemia in that area. Remember that stress echo limitations are many. Some of them are related to availability. Some of them are related to technical quality of the images, especially in someone with COPD, where the lungs are hyperinflated and it's very hard to take clear pictures of the heart, or if the patient is obese. The timing of taking the images is very crucial, so you really need a good technician to take the pictures to tell you at the end if there is ischemia or not. There is so much operator dependence, and there is a question mark about reproducibility. In general, so as I mentioned, there are several ways to do stress the heart and assess for ischemia. The most common one is the exercise ECG. Then there are the pharmacological ones with nuclear imaging and pharmacological with echo. The sensitivity of a simple exercise ECG stress test is fairly okay, around 60%. The specificity is around 75%. Definitely the sensitivity of the of a nuclear stress test and stress echo is higher. But as I mentioned, really you have to think about what's available to you, the cost, the healthcare system in general, whenever you assist such a patient with chest pain. And in general, in most of the patients, a simple exercise ECG stress test will be a good one to start with to assess if the patient pain is related to underlying coronary artery disease or not. And then if you have any question at the end of the test is not clear and so on, then we can always go to the other more advanced kinds of stress testing. So this is an algorithm that I like that can simplify things. So essentially, if you see someone with chest pain, and as I mentioned, you assess that patient and you ask him about how the patient pain feels, if it is induced by exercise, if it is relieved by resting or nitro and so on, and based on the patient age and sex and so on, you can give it a likelihood of what is the likelihood of that patient pain is being related to underlying obstructive coronary artery disease. If it is deemed to be low, less than 10 to 20%, then as I mentioned, you should think about other non-cardiac causes, like the ones I mentioned in the differential diagnosis. If the risk is felt to be high, more than 80 to 90%, then I would suggest to start medical therapy, and then such patients generally will need to be advanced to coronary artery angiography. On the other hand, if they come in that intermediate risk group, so you should ask yourself the question, is the patient able to exercise and is the patient baseline ECG is normal? If you answer yes to both, then generally an exercise ECG stress test will be a good one to start with. And if it is very abnormal with high risk features, then such patients need medical therapy and then coronary artery angiography. On the other hand, if the baseline ECG is abnormal, then you generally need a stress echo or nuclear test to assess for ischemia. And if the patient is able to exercise, then you can do the nuclear or the echocardiography with exercise. But if they cannot exercise and they have an abnormal ECG, then a pharmacological nuclear stress test or stress echo will be the way to go. And if any of these tests come back with high-risk features, strongly positive, then we would suggest to start medical therapy for coronary artery disease and advanced such patients in general to have coronary artery angiography. On the other hand, I think it's very important to keep this in mind. This algorithm, the one I just talked about, is different than the algorithm that we use to assist patients when they come to you with still active, ongoing chest pain, whether it is in an urgent care center or even in the emergency room, or sometimes come to your clinic with a missed infarction from the night before, coming to you with ongoing chest pain, thinking it is indigestion and so on. Such patients, if they are still having chest pain, looking unwell, have risk factors and so on, then you really, really need to assist them more of on emergency basis, and they need an ECG, and based on that, they likely need to have blood workup with CK and troponin in an urgent care center or emergency room. And with that, we can diagnose acute coronary syndrome, and we can tell if the patient has unstable angina or non-STEMI. And you can use something called TIMI risk score system to help you identify which patients need to go to coronary artery angiography more urgently versus the ones who can wait. And you can do a stress test first to see if they need the angiography or not. To go over the TIMI risk score, it mainly has seven components: the age, the risk factors, if the patient is known to have significant coronary artery disease from before, if the patient was on aspirin, if the chest pain is recent from the last 24 hours, if there are increased cardiac markers or ST deviation by more than 0.5 millimeter. So if the patient has TIMI score of 3 or more, so initial medical therapy need to be started right then, and early coronary angiography is needed. The general treatment, I would say, is need to start them on aspirin. Nowadays, the drug to use in acute coronary syndrome is ticagrelor, not clopidogrel, which was in the old guidelines. Beta blockers, like metoprolol, statin. Regarding the anticoagulation, it will depend on how quickly will they get their angiogram. If it is within the next few hours, then heparin will be good. If it is the next day or the following day, then low molecular weight heparin or fundaparinux can be a good one to use. On the other hand, if it is someone with like a story that's not really convincing, but there is troponin rise, there are some ECG changes, you do the TIMI risk score, it is low, then such patients, you can start on medical therapy, but do pre-discharge stress test. And if the stress test comes back abnormal or show high risk features like a drop in the ejection fraction and so on, then you consider doing the coronary angiography for such patients. So just to recap, so as I mentioned, when you see someone with chest pain, think about that broad differential diagnosis and think about coronary artery disease giving. It is a very important one to think about. It is a life-threatening one if it is the cause of chest pain. And then ask the patient the questions I mentioned about the characteristics of the chest pain, the risk factors, and so on. And then in the back of your mind, try to reach that conclusion. Is the patient risk of this pain being related to coronary artery disease low, intermediate, or high? If it is low, think about non-cardiac causes. If it is intermediate, think about stress test, and I mentioned how to order the appropriate stress test for such a patient. And if it is high, then medical therapy and advance the patient to have a coronary artery angiogram. So I'll go back to the case now. I think I have a few minutes left. So as I mentioned, this is a 62-year-old male patient, smoker, past medical history of diabetes mellitus type 2. He started having his chest pain while driving his truck in the United States, in New York, and he decided to keep driving until he's on the Canadian side, and the pain was retrosternal. When they saw him in the urgent clinic, he was still having pain, but was 8 to 9 hours after the onset of chest pain. They immediately sent him to the emergency room where we did an ECG. Here is his ECG. I'll quickly go through it. So the main thing that catches the eye is you see ST elevation in lead 2, 3, AVF, some in the lateral leads V5 and V6. You see reciprocal ST depressions in lead 1 and AVL. But also here on this ECG, you see Q waves developing inferiorly, which signifies that it is a late presentation MI and they are already infarcting some of that territory. But because they are still having chest pain and they are still showing ST elevation with the reciprocal ST depressions, this means that there is still a large chunk of that part of the heart that is still alive that can be salvaged by appropriate intervention, which is here to start medical therapy immediately, including aspirin and ticagrelor. And we were contacted in his case and took him on emergency basis to the cath lab. I'll quickly go through the cath we did for him. So here we put a catheter into the left ventricle. As you can see, the heart squeezing the front surface of the heart, which is supplied by the LED, is moving very well. But you would be able to appreciate that the inferior wall, especially the base here and the mid part, is not moving, and that's the myocardial infarction that he's actively having in the right coronary artery territory. So then we got the catheter into the right coronary artery. As you can see here, the artery is blocked right from the proximal part of it. It is a complete occlusion. We usually do quickly the left system too, just to see what we are dealing with in case the patient needs surgery and so on. So here I just put this view where we can see that there is significant narrowing in the proximal to mid left anterior descending artery, as well as in the proximal to mid OM1 branch of the circumflex coronary artery. So in his case, we quickly intervened. We opened the right coronary artery with a stent. So as you can see, it is a really huge artery supplying the whole inferior wall and a large chunk of that lateral wall. And hence you saw the ST elevation on the lateral leads in the ECG. And then in a couple of days, I brought him back to the cath lab, and we fixed the residual disease that he had, which was the left anterior descending artery and the circumflex coronary artery. And essentially, we sent him home after 2 to 3 days of being monitored in the coronary care unit. On the medical therapy, I mentioned aspirin, ticagrelor, statin, ACE inhibitor, beta blocker. Because he's a truck driver, so he's not permitted to drive his truck or commercially for 3 months. And he's not permitted to drive his personal car on his private license for a month, and then we see them by the end of that month in the clinic and repeat the echocardiography to assess for how much residual and permanent infarction is there, and we adjust the medications accordingly. Thank you. This is the end of it. I'm happy to answer any question that you have.